Hi all, there are several very exciting new Leela Chess games being played at TSEC Season 15, the Premier Division. This is at a 90 minutes with 5 second increment. This game really caught my attention against Komodo Chess Engine, a very fierce engine that knocked out the mighty Stockfish in the TSEC Cup, last TSEC Cup. So e4 from Leela. We have the Sicilian defense and the theory given to both. It's the Sicilian Najdorf variation, f4, e6, queen f3, queen b6, knight b3, queen c7, and this is the end of the book given. g4, very aggressive. b5, counterattacking. g5. Now here, for theoretical reference, for high level over the board games, a Kasparov game, Judit Polgar against Kasparov, Geneva 1996, saw Gary Kasparov playing knight fd7 here. This is quite a popular move. It's actually more popular than b4, which is what Komodo played. And in that game, Kasparov managed to get an advantage in the end game, towards the end game. I'll just quickly show you, flick through that game. So Judit Polgar was playing white, and Kasparov managed to, the queens came off after this move, knight c6, and black eventually mopped up all the pawns here on the dark squares, winning the end game. So that was an interesting game. That was eventually won at move 50. So that's with the move knight fd7. So Komodo's move is very interesting. B4, it has been played quite a few games as well. We have also a very topical, a very high-level game here with B4. There's a game, Jan Timman against Mikhail Tal, played in 1988, which saw the very shocking knight B5 from Jan Timman, and Tal with the black pieces managed to soak up the pressure. And actually, I'll just quickly flick through this game as well. Quite interesting stem games in this very topical Sicilian Najdorf. So Mikhail Tal put a lot of pressure on e4 there and crashed through. Yeah, it's just absolutely quite crushing, this one. Knight a6, end of game. That was quite a crushing game. So it seems knight b5 isn't, it might not be sound from the evidence of that game, but here in this game we have g takes f6 from Leela. So that's the end of the two theoretical references I wanted to show you. So b takes c, rook g1, g6. Here g takes f6 is also possible, but white gets, it seems, a small edge here, this position. If you look at it, there's quite good pressure on the d file, quite good control of c5 here. So g6, rook g3, knight d7, e5. Now this, it really started to catch my attention. Okay, the rook's attacked. Something has to be done about that. Bishop b7. But now, isn't this really scary for white to do? Queen takes c3. White has, if you look at the long-term aspects of the position, got a 3-1 pawn majority here on the queen side. But in the short term, isn't there something going on here? After queen takes c3, Leela preserved the structure, actually, with this move, rook takes c3. And you might think, well, isn't this tactically impossible to play? Rook takes c3. So this is the moment it really caught my attention. I thought I must show you guys this game. So after d takes, it looks as though bishop b4 doesn't have to be parried, pinning the rook. But we have just the casual f takes e5, just offering bishop b4. And it's not even, the opportunity is not taken up here for bishop b4. We have h5 instead. Opportunity is such a nice word, but is it such a great opportunity? That's the question here. If let's have a look at knight takes e5 instead, taking out a centre pawn. It seems here that kind of weakness of the last move, neglecting giving up c5 can be used with knight c5, hitting the bishop. And white gets a very nice position, for example, like this is a very nice continuation. It seems after knight c5, it's difficult for black. If bishop takes, then this position with the rook going to the 7th and taking this pawn tactically because of rook c8 is going to be a free to nothing pawn majority. White's got a big advantage there. So it's very interesting. Anyway, bishop b4 not being played immediately. But let's have a look now at bishop b4. So knight takes e5. Now let's have a look at immediate bishop b4. Why wasn't this played? Is this 3-1 really a killer here? I had to be very careful when checking this variation. Bishop d2, knight takes e5 as an example. There's rook c7 here, and white will be getting a small edge here. And the other line to think about is, just taking on c3. Bishop takes. So what is the big deal here? Well, it does have that bishop pair and has solidified the center. There is a form pawn on f6. There is a 3-1 pawn majority. Let's consider g5 as though black wants to use the 2-1 pawn majority here. Knight a5, bishop d5. Bishop d4, maintaining blockade. Kind of liberating the c-pawn. Still holding up e5. And this position, it seems, might be the way for white to play. With the knight switching back with knight c4, it seems as though technically white's getting the advantage here. It looks visually quite crushing, as though these pawns are underway. And the bishop is actually protecting the rook, so a4, b5 might even be possible later because the bishop's protecting the rook. There's no... it looks as though the pawns are really dangerous here. So perhaps that's why it was rejected by the Komodo chess engine, the whole bishop b4. So I've just thought this was extremely curious, playing on the pawn majority subtly in a way. So h5, and now knight a5 is played, hitting the bishop. Bishop d5, knight c4. Bishop, now the offer is taken up here with bishop b4 in any case. We have bishop d2, bishop takes c4, bishop takes rook takes c4. Is there enough here after knight takes e5? 3-1 pawn majority, form pawn, a6 target, which is now even further targeted with rook a4. Black castled with check here. If a5, you might wonder. It seems bishop g2 is pretty good. Here, for example, check and taking. Yeah, it's going to be difficult for black. And I suspect b4 if the rook tries to hold around the a file. So black castled with check here, though, instead of playing a5, and we have king c3. Knight g4, so the a6 pawn is for the taking. But first we had rook e1, stopping any pesky knight e3 perhaps. So rook e1, now the knight took on f6. And instead of taking on a6, b4, knight d5 check, king b3. So it gives that b3 for the king without hemming in the pawns. So that's a really key consideration with white's play here, not to hem in this lovely pawn majority, make sure it gets its full potential. And now finally this is taken, we have a 3-0 pawn majority. And you might think, well, black's got a pawn majority over here, but it's a race situation perhaps. White's not even the exchange down or anything here. An interesting pawn majority race scenario. So f5, statistically though, these pawns are all on the light squares, which is good for the light square bishop at the moment. Of course they can be moved forward, you'd think. b5 Rook h8, b6, but yeah, white's pawn is pretty quick with tempo. And now we have bishop b5, and it's black which actually does give up the exchange here with knight takes b6. If black tries to preserve the rook with rook e7, it seems as though here c4 is strong. For example, knight takes b6, rook a6, and here knight c8. For example, this is very nice for white. Yeah, the pawns are big targets. This is overall better for white. And if we look at this again with king b7, c5, knight d5, and this taking on e6, again, white is significantly better here. For example, like this, with a big advantage. Yeah. So, it seems as though, yeah, black's giving up the exchange. And Komodo really hasn't lost any games up until this point. So is it really, has it really worked this one out as well to be drawish? Because it, up to now, undefeated in this tournament. And this is like round 35. Pardon me. It might have lost the stockfish, of course. I need to check that. Okay, I shouldn't say that. Without checking. But anyway, hasn't lost that many games. So we have bishop takes e8, rook takes e8, rook d4. I'm pretty sure it did lose to Stockfish at least one or two. Stockfish has been dominating the event. So let's just go with that assumption. But apart from that, the other engines, it's pretty solid. So knight a8 here. Rook g1, king c7, and this pawn drops off. And yes, this exchange up scenario isn't that great for black, as you might expect. So let's see some technique. So the rook coming in over here, picking off this pawn. This h pawn moving. And these pawns are now targeted. And white is going to use this H pawn, basically. It's not just the exchange up. It's the fact is the H pawn is pretty dangerous here. So it's pushed as well as the outside A pawn. So we've got two outside pawns stretching black's pieces. The knight can't cope. And this is like basically giving up playing E4. The game actually ended here. So as an example continuation, H6. Knight takes a7, h7, check. This is just an example continuation. We can use that h pawn to get our winning position much more clearly. So yeah, I thought it was an interesting game, this whole offer of the exchange sacrifice, but it's, yeah, a deeper context here, pawn majorities. So I thought it was quite interesting to cover, and I want to try and cover the other interesting games as I see from this tournament. I want to get back into that. If you enjoyed this game video, then please click on the top left box, which should appear shortly. Become a member at chessmold.net to play against other YouTubers. You can also test yourself on the variations covered in this and other game videos from the improved menu at Chessmold, the puzzle books, which has a link to the annotated game. Comments, questions, donations, see the description. Like, share, subscribe with the notification bell. Really appreciate it. Thanks very much.